The Philippine Commission on Human Rights reminds the COMELEC criticism is part of freedom of expression. That's after COMELEC Commissioner Ray Bulay threatened to arrest individuals criticizing the poll body's preparations for the May 9 elections. Now, the CHR asserts due process must be followed as it is only a judge who can issue a warrant of arrest. For his thoughts on this and other election matters, we are joined by Contradaya convener Mr. Danilo Arao. Welcome to the program, Mr. Arao.
Good morning to all of you, Nikki and Stanley, and thank you for having me.
Good morning. Now, the Commission on Elections vows to run after those who are maligning the Commission on Elections, especially those who are peddling supposed baseless accusations against the office. Now, what do you make of this? While it has the right to protect the integrity of a poll body, is this really the way to go?
We find it unfortunate that there would be remarks from that from a high-ranking COMELEC official because, as correctly noted by the Commission on Human Rights, there is due process when it comes to going after those who are doing something out of the ordinary or something that's illegal. There's nothing illegal, just for the record, about criticizing certain institutions and certain government officials. That's part of our democratic space. And we call on the COMELEC to listen to the sentiments of the public, whether or not it's something that's positive or negative to their image. Because there are cases where there is constructive criticism, and such criticism would be evidence-based. And there's factual basis for having such kinds of perspective.
All right. Now, the Commission on Elections has never before attempted to really run after its critics in the past when it had always its share of criticisms. Commissioner Ray Bulay is saying it has the armed forces under its control, which can be tasked to round up those who have publicly insinuated that the Commission on Elections is biased towards specific candidates or that it is committing fraud. Now, what kind of message is this sending as regards accountability and public offices supposedly being open to criticism?
Of course, it sends the wrong optics. It makes it appear that there is an authoritarian tendency that's happening right now in our current COMELEC, which is not good, by the way, because right now the Duterte administration has been roundly criticized for the reign of tyranny and the culture of impunity that practically becomes an inherent part of the executive branch. We don't want that kind of image being extended to the body that is supposed to supervise the 2022 polls. So if you want us to talk in Filipino for just a short while, hindi dapat maging asal diktador ang kasalukuyang COMELEC. We cannot afford to do that. So we hope that Commissioner Bulay and some other COMELEC commissioners would refrain from making such irresponsible remarks.
Okay, now the latest COMELEC action stems from calls for it to hold honest, orderly, and peaceful elections, an action which is viewed as sowing distrust on the integrity of the election body. Now, aside from actually running after critics, what, to you, should the Commission on Elections instead do to address criticism?
There are two ways they can do that. One is full transparency, and second would be full accountability. So what do we mean by that? There are a lot of issues right now related to the elections which are not made clear to the public. One of them would be the data breach on allegedly the servers of the Smartmatic or even the COMELEC. We don't know the extent of such data breach. We need full accountability on certain issues happening at the overseas absentee voting level because we don't know yet whether or not it's true that one candidate's name has been allegedly missing in one ballot.
Right.
We've been getting reports on the ground that the party list race consists of 178 names instead of only 177. From what I know, one of them has been erased, even if the number is still 178 by virtue of disqualification. But the name of that particular party list group is apparently still there. So, you know, these things should be duly investigated and the results should be made open to the public. Now, with regard to the data breach, we also call on the National Bureau of Investigation to be public when it comes to the conduct of its investigation. I understand the results are already out, but it's not made public still.
Okay, I'd like to go back later to the missing names on the ballot. Meanwhile, the Commission on Elections has its hands full in the final weeks into the elections. Now, do you think pursuing critics is productive at this juncture, even if it says it has resources under its disposal to carry this out? I mean, what are you most apprehensive about once they do this?
Of course, it's counterproductive because the COMELEC should focus on clean and orderly elections. And just for the record, the COMELEC has under its control the AFP and the PNP to ensure clean and honest elections, not to run after perceived enemies of the state or the critics for that matter. So I think the COMELEC is abusing its authority whenever they brandish the long arms of the COMELEC, of the PNP, or even the AFP. These arms do not extend to the COMELEC, and they are abusing their authority if they think that they can use the body that is supposed to be nonpartisan for certain activities that would infringe on our inherent freedom of expression.
All right. Now, going back to missing names on the ballots, our election top story today, a viral post from New Zealand and the ongoing overseas voting there, where it was observed that a ballot does not contain the complete list of presidential candidates. There are also other voting-related problems in New York and Shanghai, as you mentioned. What is your take on these impediments, and do you believe there is still time to rectify any of these issues?
We have chapters abroad, and we have yet to get full documentation of that particular incident in Wellington. But we will be careful not to say that it's already fake news, unlike a certain COMELEC commissioner who is quick to dismiss certain controversies as fake news. We won't do that. However, I've received through the email such concerns. We are still trying to look at the primary source of information, because that's the way to go. Our call, I understand that the Wellington embassy is now trying to get to the bottom of it. Our call for them is to ensure that these findings are made public, and that the information, whether or not it's fake news and whether or not it's real, would have to be made known to the public as soon as possible.
Yes, another problem brought up recently is the precinct finder, where some voters could not find their names or precinct lists that contain deceased voters. How confident are you that these will be resolved in time for the elections, and how big an effect will this be, in your view, to our election process?
Actually, the problem extends more than that. On the first day that it was active, the first time that it was online, we had difficulty in accessing it. I myself was unable to access my own name as well as my family member's status in the COMELEC until the wee hours of the night. So there's that persistent technology issue. We're confident that this particular technical glitches would be solved in due time. However, the master list of voters would be another matter altogether. Our call for the public, once they're able to access precinct, their precinct finder interface on their respective devices, please ensure that your status is really active. If your records are not found or it's wrongly deactivated, please bring it to the attention of the local COMELEC. However, as early as now, we call on the COMELEC and the DICT, which is supposed to be in charge of the precinct finder, to address all technical issues, because the patience of many people would run thin if they do not address such technical glitches.
Okay, yet on another concern, the postponement of last weekend's debates due to problems with a group that the COMELEC has partnered with to handle these events. How should the COMELEC address this, and do you like the way it's being handled?
Right now, there are certain issues that are left hanging because we cannot find certain information about the contract with Impact Hub Manila.
Right.
We don't know anything about it. Although, of course, there is a certain track record of Impact Hub Manila But for large events like this, I don't think they have the experience for that. So there has to be a clear accounting of how and why Impact Hub Manila was selected for such kind of big activity. Now, I understand that the COMELEC denies that public funds were not used. So how was Impact Hub Manila able to roll out an important event like this? Did they spend funds on their own? Why did they do so? So we find it hard to believe that no public funds have been used, or at least not yet. So the COMELEC should come clean as regards the kind of partnership that it has made with Impact Hub Manila. So just for the record, we need full transparency and full accountability regarding what happened.
Okay, we are on the final stretch of the national elections happening in 2 weeks, with the 2022 polls polarized, with candidates and supporters, of course, in high emotion. Now, how worried are you of election fraud at this time, and what kind of reports or perhaps apprehensions have you been getting on the ground in terms of election fraud?
The incidence of vote buying has been increasing just like before, because what happened in the past election cycles is that we expect such nefarious activities to intensify. The misuse and abuse of government resources have become the order of the day. And of course, the spread of disinformation will even be more intense. So we call on the people, whether or not you are supporters of a particular candidate, to be careful in terms of what you share on social media, because fake news would tend to appeal to the emotions of people. And you are being set up to distract you from your focus, which is to campaign for a particular candidate. I hope you won't do that. And this call applies to all sides of the political spectrum right now. So we have to do our share in terms of clean and honest elections by only sharing the truth and fighting the kind of disinformation that's happening right now.
Okay, now, Professor Arao, your group, Contra Daya, is at the forefront of promoting clean, peaceful, orderly, and honest elections. What are you doing differently this time? As you said, the occasion calls for more vigilance on the part of everyone, particularly the electorate. So is there anything new that you're doing in these elections in the context of fighting fraud?
For the most part, we've been doing practically the same as the time that we were established in 2007. Perhaps what you can say to be something different would be the fact-checking initiatives that we're doing. In the past, we didn't do any fact-checking. But for this particular election cycle, we've decided to do so. And in fact, we've joined forces with two of the biggest fact-checking networks in the country, Check.ph and FactsFirst.ph, so that we can help contribute to the discourse on fact-checking. And hopefully, they can help us amplify our intended message. Our focus on fact-checking would be on the partyless race, because this is the fact-checking angle that's not explored fully by several fact-checking networks. So we've decided to do that because we have our own data set to rely on.
All right. Is there any website that the people can access when they want to fact-check, or when they want to see the results of your fact-checking of party lists?
Everything is available on our website, contradaya.org. And our fact-checks, we've had four so far, are available also on our social media accounts. On Twitter, it's at Contradaya, and on Facebook, it's Contra.Daya.
And what did you find out so far in terms of party lists?
There are a lot of false claims. There are also certain claims that need context, and there are a lot of misleading statements provided by several party list groups. And this is consistent with our flagging, because at least 70% of the 177 party list groups running in the current election cycle would be either part of the political dynasty, they would belong to big business, would have questionable advocacies, they may have party list nominees who are incumbent local officials, or would have pending cases. So these categories would tend to point to the fact that the party list system has not been for the marginalized and the underrepresented. In fact, the irony would be true. The party list system is marginalizing the already marginalized.
All right, lastly, Professor Arao, you also teach journalism at the University of the Philippines. You were among those who protested the shutdown of ABS-CBN because of its implications on press freedom. Now, what can you say about former Malacanang spokesperson Harry Roque's statement during a UNI team rally in Manila? I understand we have a sound bite of that with us. Let's listen in first.
Ate Ai, hindi ka nagkamali na sinamahang grupo. Hindi mawawala ang iyong prangkisa.
Okay, what do you say to that?
That's an irresponsible joke. Of course, he will always say that it's just a joke and that he just wants to liven up the crowd. But that's a very, very irresponsible joke because, as you correctly mentioned, it's an attack on press freedom when you shut down a network, regardless of what the government would feel about its kind of reportage. You know, Stanley, there are several news media organizations that engage in irresponsible journalism right now. Let's mention them. SMNI would be one of them. But do we call for the shutdown of SMNI? No. But we call them out because of the irresponsibility that they're doing where they kowtow to the powers that be. So the same case should apply to ABS-CBN. And for a senatorial candidate to make fun of what the Duterte administration did, which is clearly an attack on press freedom, would tell much about that kind of character of that candidate. So he should stop making jokes and just talk about programs if and when he gets elected as senator. And with this, and with that kind of actuation, it further confirms the kind of character that he is, that he has practically abandoned his fight for press freedom and his for being a champion of human rights. So I don't want to say it on record, but I might as well say it. Shame on him for making such remarks.
All right, let's leave it at that. Thank you very much for your insights, Professor Danilo Arao. Thanks for joining us today.
Thank you very much.